We culture.
Disney today is by all means a media conglomerate. They own everything. Star Wars, Marvel, recently more Marvel, ESPN, Pixar, Wait, what? GoPro.
Why?
Among a lot of other ridiculous shit that they don't need to own, but can because capitalism. Now, I'm not here to rant about how Disney is one of the best modern examples of why capitalism is terrible, but instead, I'd rather give an insightful spiel on a time when the company just simply wanted to make great animated films. You know, like, original fucking content, not just taking a movie you've already made, then re-slapping it with some CGI and boom.
Oh, God diggity dang.
Aladdin, everybody. Not the films anyone asked for, but the ones good old Mick says we need. Now let me make this clear. The Jungle Book was pretty good, and I'm most definitely seeing The Lion King. Donald Glover, Beyonce, Seth Rogen, James Earl Jones, and Eric Andre.
Oof.
You alright?
Lauren, what's going on with you?
Oh yeah, I'm seeing that. Now, do I think it's going to be any good? Probably not. But I think everyone deep down knows is either A, going to be terrible, B, a CGI copy of the original film, or C, both. Now let's get to the topic at hand. The Experimental Five. The Experimental Five are the first five Disney films released theatrically. These films include Snow White, Pinocchio, Fantasia, Dumbo, and Bambi. There's no similarity between these films in terms of style, writing, and overall theme. This is a time when Walt was far more involved with the creative process of his films, which wasn't the case post-Bambi era as he became more distant. The film that made Disney the animation standard was by all means Snow White. There was simply nothing like it. From the animation, writing, and overall sophistication, Snow White proved that animation wasn't just for cheap slapstick laughs, but could be just as powerful as any other medium of the day. Snow White is art at its finest. But before we dive into the actual production of Snow White, the role before should be understood.
You're going to be the Cookie Queen, all alone the reason why. Got the picture here, right? Here's the way to do it. There's nothing to it.
The innovative techniques seen in Snow White were first experiments in all through Disney's Silly Symphonies. These were high-end shorts that pushed the boundaries of what was seen in animation at the time. Never before seen technology was displayed through the shorts such as The Old Mill, which introduced the multiplane camera. This camera gave a three-dimensional illusion, allowing for objects to move farther away, coming closer, without compromising the effect. It was far more efficient to use this method instead of just stacking cells on top of each other through a regular camera. This process limited cartoons to a very two-dimensional look. In this case, the cells were separated individually, allowing animators to control depth, speed, and movement up to seven layers. While shorts such as The Old Mill focused on pushing technology of animation, other shorts focused on breaking the stigma of animation being just slapstick.
How many lumps do you want?
Oh, three or four.
Got it!
This can be seen through the skeleton dance, which bridges the mediums of music, animation, and dance into one film. The skeleton dance was very avant-garde at the time, as no cartoon prior successfully experimented with all these mediums in such a unique, yet cohesive way. Silly Symphony set the foundation for the vision, technique, and stellar animation seen in Snow White. Based on the Brother Grimm's tale, the production for Snow White began as early as 1934, and Walt was very passionate about it, more than anything he produced prior. Disney even held a company-wide meeting and reenacted the entire plot of Snow White as he envisioned. The manifestation of Walt's vision, however, was a long and grueling process, to say the least. At the time, almost all cartoons had a rubber hose style and very few strived for realism. To ensure realism in Snow White, Walt brought in art professors from across the country to perfect the animator's craft. The professors taught styles such as Impressionism, Cubism, and Expressionism. Three-dimensional models of the characters and sets were created as a design reference for the artists too. The studio was broken down into three groups: key animators who would draw and make the characters, in-betweeners who would draw the movement between the keyframes, and the ink and paint artists who would add color to the drawings and then transfer them to transparent sheets. A typical day for a key animator consisted of working on Snow White during the day and attending acting classes at night. Acting classes helped artists understand how to develop realistic mannerisms and facial expressions. A teenage dancer was hired to act out the part of Snow White as animators diligently studied her. This was also done for other characters in the film. They were even filmed to capture a sense of personality, movement, and realism. These actors were also used for recording purposes as their movement was either drawn on the spot or directly rotoscoped. As most know, color is essential to creating mood, so Disney chemists custom mixed various colors for backgrounds and characters. In total, 1,500 separate shades were used to paint 1.5 million drawings of Snow White. Both the Queen and Snow White had actual makeup applied to their faces as it made their appearances more convincing. None of these tasks were easy for any group, as the work was just as intricate as making a watch. The slightest mishap could ruin an entire scene, appearance, or motion of a character. At 24 frames per second and multiple cells per frame, Snow White required more than 200,000 separate drawings by mid-production. Walt and his brother Roy will end up having to rent and build extra building space to accommodate their growing staff of 600 plus people. Roy historically doesn't get enough credit for his contributions to the company. Without Roy, the film simply wouldn't have been completed, as Walt had a pretty risky business acumen. It was his brother's job to keep investors, staff, and all the other aspects of the company under control. All Walt really cared about was communicating his new product onto the big screen. This eventually became problematic as production started to drag by the third year. Walt's vision in most eyes became borderline delusional and a detriment to the studio. Deadlines kept being pushed back, and the film was completely behind schedule for its upcoming premiere. With just under 10 minutes left till the premiere, not a single cell had been shot on film. Despite all these mishaps, Walt insisted that the film cannot be rushed or produced cheaply. His insistence on creating the perfect film forced Roy to increase the budget 6 times over. Luckily, animators managed to finish in early November, while the final sets were painted on by the end of the month. Everyone from Roy, Walt's wife Lillian, and even the press at the time were convinced that the film was going to be a flop. Lillian believed it was impossible to keep audiences' attention of an animated film that long. The media referred to it as Disney's folly, implying that the film was going to be a flop because of all the missed deadlines and continuously increasing budget. Walt, ignoring all negativity, still deep down believed that his film was a masterpiece that no one had ever experienced before.
Here's George Aulis, Dean of Stage and Screen, and Luella Parsons, leading Hollywood commentator. Handsome Preston Foster, one of the most popular stars with the fans. Shirley Temple is just as enthralled as are the grown-up stars and moviegoers with the seven fantastic dwarfs.
On December 21st, 1937, Snow White premiered in Hollywood at the Carthay Circle Theater. The premiere was attended by celebrity guests such as Clark Gable, Shirley Temple, and Doug Fairbanks Jr. Disney himself was anxious, not knowing if all his daughter's predictions would be accurate. As the film began to play, audiences gasped at the opening shots of the Queen's castle and hissed at the Queen herself. Despite these positive reactions, it was Snow White's funeral that convinced Disney the film was a success. The audience itself was crying in unison with the doors at her wake. This connection between audience and animation proved Disney's doubters wrong. Walt, Roy, and their staff had helped create a new art form within animation. Snow White proved animation could encompass the human condition just as every other medium, possibly better. Through its innovative art style, it destroyed what a cartoon can and should look like. This style reflects a European world and storybook. These worlds tend to balance fantasy and realism, thus making the film more plausible in terms of character design and setting. The payoff of the animator's hard work can be seen through the distinct movement and facial expression of each dwarf. Prior to this, most dwarf characters in cartoons were identical, with Disney being no exception.
Fit their personalities. This pompous-looking individual is Doc, self-appointed leader of the group. And this little fellow is bashful.
It was in Snow White that we first saw a set of distinguished dwarf characters. These distinctions can also save a lot of time from a writer's perspective as it eliminates unnecessary exposition. Why spend 10 minutes divulging to who's who when it can be shown in 2 minutes or less? As far as cinematic influences, there are numerous, such as Romeo and Juliet, Nosferatu, The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, and Dr. Jekyll and Hyde. The eerie scene of Snow White walking through the forest at night is a direct homage to Dr. Caligari, Nosferatu, and German Expressionism. Broadly speaking, German Expressionism is an artistic movement that rejects Western conventions and the depiction of reality that is widely distorted for emotional effect. The forest scene is distorted to strike fear into the audience and immerse one into the scene itself. Another cinematic homage in the film is the Queen's Transformation, which is a reference to Jekyll and Hyde. The scene is particularly interesting as it fully expands the technology of the multiplane camera. The camera was used to give a rotating effect once the Queen drank the potion. This was done by moving layers in different directions, giving the illusion of a whirling motion. The film overall used the multiplane camera in ways that standardized how animated films are made to this very day. Snow White looking down at the well, it wasn't possible. The perspective of flying an animal from top to bottom wasn't possible. All of these aspects that we take for granted in animation began with Silly Symphonies and Snow White. The Disney team managed to create a new art form within animation that rivaled any other live action film at the time. As far as its premiere, it was met with a standing ovation, and the worldwide release matched its positive reaction. Snow White ended up growing $8 million its first year, the equivalent to over $100 million today. Snow White was the first time art, product, and commerce met through the realm of merchandise. There were Snow White scarves, toys, games, jellies, dresses, and even phonograph records. In fact, it was the first film to ever feature a soundtrack. Amazing. Now, with all the money in the world, Disney did what most would do in this position. Make more animated films. Interestingly enough, Disney would soon find out that his money wasn't as infinite, and such a high budget can make it almost impossible to gross profit. After the release of Snow White, Disney's ambition finally matches Capital, thus opening a new realm of possibilities. The next two films to be released were Pinocchio, Fantasia, and Bambi, all being developed at the same time. Due to major financial losses between Pinocchio and Fantasia, Bambi's release will end up being delayed. This is one of the reasons Dumbo was released before Bambi, as it was a far cheaper production than any of the five films. The production of Dumbo was half the cost of Snow White, less than a third of the cost of Pinocchio, and far less than Fantasia. It was a safe film from a production standpoint, but releasing the film at the advent of World War II was extremely risky. Now that we have a general understanding of this tumultuous time at the Disney Studios, let's dive into the second film, everyone's favorite puppet-turned-boy, Pinocchio.
When your heart is in your dream, oh.
The development of Pinocchio was difficult from concept to its actual production. The original story of Pinocchio by Carlo Collodi was episodic, making it difficult to narrow down into one cohesive film. Not only was the story difficult to adapt, but so was the main star, Pinocchio. Collodi's version of Pinocchio was very mean, and to be real, he was terrible. That's not even an exaggeration either, and I'll give you a quick rundown. So as soon as Dude becomes alive, he literally runs away from Geppetto and claims he abused him, landing Geppetto in jail. Then there's him and Jiminy Cricket. All Jiminy tries to do throughout the whole book is tell Pinocchio, "Hey bruh, you're bugging out." And Pinocchio, in return for this advice, smashes Jimbo with a hammer. His stupid decisions, or as Collodi would put it, disobedient, actually led to him being hanged. Yeah. So after the hanging, some blue fairy comes in and saves the day. Boom. Happily ever after. Honestly, if Disney was ever going to reboot a film, they should reboot Pinocchio and keep it faithful to the source material. That'd actually be dope. You could essentially make a better Chucky, which, if we're being honest, isn't the hardest thing to do. Wait, that's a thing?
You sure? Who else could have it been? Who do you think?
Oh, no. It wasn't me, it was you.
How do you know?
Shut up.
Did you see me?
Shut up.
If you weren't there, how can you be so sure it was me?
Shut up, shut up, shut up, shut up!
What is going on here?
But back to Disney. Essentially, after months of character drafts, most of which were unappealing, the Disney team eventually agreed on a more friendly design for Pinocchio. This design is the perfect balance between an actual young boy and a puppet. Sure, you can see he's a puppet, but he's not intimidating in the slightest. The person mainly credited with his magnificent transformation and character design was the legendary Milk Call, who also worked on Snow White. One aspect of the novel that carried over into the film was the concept of consciousness. Pinocchio has learned to trust his good conscience in order to avoid being led astray by manipulators. In this case, like the novel, the conscience is Jiminy Cricket. The design for Jiminy Cricket was also difficult, as crickets, according to most, are unappealing. This redesign was tasked by War Kimball, another legendary animator. The designs of both Pinocchio and Jiminy show that the personality of a character is at times more important than the actual physicality, meaning if Jiminy is supposed to be friendly and inviting, focus the design on that, rather than basing the design on the fact he's a cricket. In terms of personality, Jiminy is your typical wisecracking character who tries to keep Pinocchio on the straight path. Of course, Pinocchio ignores Jiminy, which is essentially the driving force of the story. An interesting aspect about Pinocchio that's often neglected is the tremendous growth in skill amongst the animators from Snow White. Pinocchio, by all means, is the original gold standard of effects animation. While most modern animation enthusiasts would give that title to Akira, Spirited Away, maybe The Little Mermaid, the fact of the matter is all films mentioned were released under 35 years ago, whereas Pinocchio will be turning 80 next year. The fact Pinocchio can still hold weight with some of the best animated films is truly an amazing feat. The reason Pinocchio managed to hold up so well after all these years stems from the animator's precision to detail. In order to maintain consistency between scenes similar to the likes of Snow White, it was the creation of 3D model sculptures. These sculptures allow for animators to not lose form across multiple segments. One of the more elaborate examples of this would be Stromboli's carriage, which was used not only as a point of reference but also filmed using stop motion animation. These recordings were then transferred onto cells using an early version of Xerox paper. This technique allows animators to see and replicate the actual quality of the carriage's movement. Another set of model clocks were used to create the ones in Geppetto's workshop. These clocks were then filmed from specific angles and subsequently animated through the same process. Blending realistic conventions such as the motion of wagons with traditional cartoon design is what the film achieves best, thus giving the audience an overall convincing experience. The influx of different animation styles into one seamless film was also an astonishing achievement. The best example of this was the pool scene between Jiminy, Pinocchio, and Lampwick. Jiminy was being animated by Ward Kimball, Pinocchio by Milk Call, and Lampwick was done by Freddie Moore. Knowing this, one can see how they play off each other's styles. Kimball seems to have more of a demanding style of animation, most likely due to his character being undersized. Call's job with Pinocchio is to give off an innocent, almost Disney-like vibe, hence his happy yet clumsy style throughout the entire film. As for Moore's job with Lampwick, there's a laid-back yet stern style of animation, since he represents the standard of cool through Pinocchio's eyes.
Tell me where we can find Monstro. Gee, they're scared.
Now, the most iconic element of this film would definitely have to be the underwater sequences. The scenes were so detailed that they had specific teams of animators tasked to work solely on bubble and water effects. Some worked on nothing but water effects for a whole year. In the opening water scenes, animators decided to add depth to the ocean by putting more detail into the waves on the water surface in the foreground and put less detail as the surface moves further back. This draws upon a more impressionistic style, as it allows animators to greatly improve the detail in the front. The scenes with Monstro coinciding with the thunderous sound were also a true spectacle. A scene like this alongside Lampwick's transformation is reminiscent of a Hitchcock style of film, where reaction overshadows the action itself. Pinocchio's reaction to Lampwick turning into a donkey, and Geppetto Pinocchio frantically running away from Monstro makes both scenes far more intensifying. This isn't to take away from either action, but the reactions are so plausible and relatable that it makes the scenes more immersive, therefore effective. Lampwick's deconstruction from a very arrogant, prideful character to a traumatized like child, all in a matter of seconds, is perfect visual storytelling. Pinocchio not only innovated in the realms of writing and animation, but also in sound. One scene that is a testament to this premise is the birthing of Pinocchio. In this case, the blue fairy makes Pinocchio alive through her wand. Now, most may be amazed at the wand's animation, but what about the sound? I strongly believe this is one of the earliest instances of what we perceive magic to sound, if not the first. The wand sound was a mixture of strings, nova chords, and celesta. All these instruments combined helped create a uniform ethereal sound. As for the underwater scenes, a couple theories were found, both being very experimental and effective. The first theory stems from a more traditional route. Back in these days, film had to be held with a tight catch as it passes over the optical sound drum of a recording machine. If not held tight, the film was slightly looped, forcing the sound to flutter. The sound effects people inserted a wire yoke, called a butterfly, into the reproducer to hold the catch open in the recording machine. As the voice of Pinocchio called out, the fluttering gave a realistic underwater gurgle to the sound. The other theory states that a mic was placed in the middle of a small water mill, then the actor would speak into the waterfall over the wheel. Regardless of which experiment was actually conducted, the sound is still very convincing. Pinocchio also has layers of cultural significance in voice acting, as it was the first animated film to feature a celebrity, in this case Cliff Edwards. Edwards voiced Jiminy Cricket and is known for his number one single, Singing in the Rain. Overall, Pinocchio is a phenomenal production that I'd recommend anyone to this very day. If Snow White represented the possibilities of what can be done in animation, then Pinocchio proved from a technical standpoint that animation is truly boundless. From a financial standpoint, however, Pinocchio was a flop, with the budget being extremely too high to make profit. This didn't discourage Walt though, as he was sure his third film, Fantasia, was going to be a sure hit. This concludes part one of the Experimental 5. I hope you found this video both informative and entertaining. I'm interested to hear your thoughts, so drop your comments down below. Like and subscribe. Peace and love.